Hey, I'm Leslie. In the past couple of weeks, we've been looking at words that come up around Christmas time. And these aren't just any words. They're words that are actually tied to a time of year, a tradition called Advent, okay? And Advent is all about preparing for Christmas, not just showing up on Christmas Day saying, "Where are all my presents?" but actually preparing for the arrival of Jesus. We talked about hope and we've talked about peace. And so today we're gonna talk about joy. And here's the thing about joy. It's not a word that we use often, right? And when we hear it, we often think of it as just a lot of happiness. For example, happiness is when you find a $5 bill in your jacket, but joy is when you find $20 bills, right? Or perhaps happiness is when you get an extension on your English paper, but joy, that's when the whole paper has been canceled. Does that make sense, right? Except that's not exactly how it works, right? Happiness and joy are actually kind of similar, but there's more to them than one just being a better version of the other. Happiness is a reaction. Something happens to you, the people you love, or the circumstances you're living in, and you react by being happy, right? You didn't have to do anything. You just feel happy because something happened that you like. For example, like you have a really cool experience, or you get a prayer that's answered, or you get some quality time with a good friend, or you receive an amazing gift, or you entered into an exciting season like Christmas. See, all of those things are great, but they aren't exactly joy. Joy is different. Like maybe you've even heard this phrase, choose joy, and that makes you think that joy is all about just being optimistic. But let's be honest, that sounds a little bit exhausting. It makes it seem like joy is like good vibes only and acting like everything is fine even when it isn't, or focusing only on the good stuff and ignoring the bad stuff. For real, like that just sounds impossible. And also it just seems kind of fake, okay? But joy is deeper than that. It comes from a more authentic place. It's a lot more lasting. It doesn't ignore the hard stuff in life, but it doesn't let the hard stuff determine how you feel. And I don't know about you, but that's something I definitely want in my life. So how do we experience that? How do we have joy when things change and life doesn't go exactly how we thought? Or how do we not ignore the difficult stuff but still find a way to make it through? Do we just keep waiting for joy to happen to us, or do we just give up on it? Is there a way to experience it no matter what? I think there is. There's a place that we can choose to look to where joy will always be possible, not just around Christmas and not just when everything is happening like we expect or want, but no matter what. So in the New Testament, the second part of the Bible, there's a book named Luke, okay? And Luke was the author. Luke's account gives us a lot of information about Jesus's birth. See, Luke was a Gentile, which means that he wasn't Jewish. And therefore, that means he was largely excluded from all of the religious community. He wrote to an audience of people who were also Gentiles, right? So he's like, I'm one of you, I'm talking to you. So the details that he included there were for a specific purpose. He wanted readers who weren't Jewish to know that the birth of Jesus was for them too, not just for other people who were Jewish. He wanted his readers to know that Jesus was nothing like the Roman leaders that they were used to. Luke talks about things like how Jesus was the Son of God and how he was born in a manger instead of a palace. He told us that Jesus was born to an unmarried teenage girl and not a rich family, right, in the Jewish community. And in Luke 2, he tells us how a group of shepherds, a job that would have made them dirty, unclean according to religious law, and outcasts of society, were some of the first people to hear the news of Jesus' birth. In other words, Luke wanted them to know that Jesus changed everything. Luke wanted his readers to know that Jesus and the message he represented was far different than anything they had ever heard before. And even better, the message was for everyone. So Luke writes this, "And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. So the shepherds are just kind of minding their own business in the middle of a field, in the middle of the night, when an angel, a literal angel, appears. And if you've ever read anything about angels showing up in the Bible, it's like they always start with the same line, like, do not be afraid, right? That makes me wonder, like, what did they look like if afraid was the expected response? Either way, that's what the angels say. Don't be afraid. And then the angel talks about having good news. Okay, and so to the people living at that time in the Roman Empire, that phrase good news was something they'd heard so many times before. They would have been familiar with it because Caesar kind of used that phrase to describe what he was doing as the ruler of the empire, right? They said, it's good that we're in power. And so they heard this phrase good news all the time. But basically this angel is like, no, I have actual good news, news that will bring actual joy. It's the start of better things. So what was this news? Well, the news is that today, a Savior and Messiah has been born. And again, all those words would have made those people back then think of an earthly king, right? A ruler like Caesar. But the angel said that this is news for all people. And the good news of Rome wasn't good news for everybody, right? The good news that came from Rome was only good to certain people. But the good news from God was good news for all people. Jewish people, non-Jewish people, people who were poor, people who were rich, people who were privileged, people who were underprivileged, literally everyone. Okay, so Luke goes on. He says this, suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth, peace to those whom his favor rests. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us again. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. See, the shepherds didn't just want to take the angel at its word. No, they wanted to experience it for themselves. Why? Well, I mean, think about it. They had lived their whole lives being considered an afterthought, unclean or unholy, unimportant, left out, overlooked. And yet the angel chose them to be the first people to hear the good news that was for all people. The people who were uninvited and who didn't belong before were now the first group of people to learn about the good news. See, joy for people like the shepherds typically would have been hard to find, but the angel said it was theirs to experience. Not because Jesus was going to be Caesar or was going to put new people in power, but because the news of great joy was possible no matter who was in power. No matter what was happening, no matter who was calling the shots. In other words, the angels were saying, nothing around you may change, but your experience of Jesus can still change everything. It can give you joy no matter how bad things are. And that means that the good news for the shepherds is good news for us right now. See, joy is something that we can choose today, no matter what our circumstances look like. And how do we know that? Well, let's skip ahead a bit to a passage in the book of Hebrews, which was written after Jesus had died and been resurrected. The early church was exploding in growth, okay? So in this book, the author is talking to a group of Christians who are being persecuted for their faith. That means that basically they were enduring all kinds of hardships that they would have never chose. They were wondering if it was even worth it to follow Jesus. And they probably didn't think joy was something that they could experience because of how bad their life was going. The writer says this, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. See, the author says, even with dying on the cross ahead of him, Jesus was able to have joy because of what was ahead. He got through it because he knew there was something on the other side of it. He knew that the cross wasn't the end of the story. Jesus chooses the cross, right? The path that would have seemed the least joy-filled in order to show us what love looked like. And knowing that the true character and love of God would be made clear in his suffering on the cross, that is what gave Jesus his joy. Because his dying on the cross made a way for us to be in relationship with God and experience God's love. And when we experience this love of God, it is the key to our joy. In other words, joy shows up in unexpected places, in surprising ways. Joy is possible no matter where you are in life and no matter how difficult it is. It can be reached, it can be experienced, and it is all because of Jesus. He models joy in the most unexpected places. He proves to us that joy has nothing to do with things going the way we want. It has nothing to do with us denying difficult things in life, right? It's found in spite of it and in the midst of it. And Jesus makes it available to us. See, the shepherds experienced it 2,000 years ago when an angel told them that joy was possible because good news was for all people. And we can experience it today because that same good news from 2,000 years ago is still good news of great joy for us. See, God is with us and God is for us. And because of him, this kind of joy is possible. Okay, so now we have to activate it. And that starts with this simple phrase I want you to remember if you don't remember anything else. Where there is not joy, bring it. Okay? See, maybe the idea of finding joy seems impossible right now. And yes, sometimes it is difficult, but it's not impossible. As you think about this idea of joy in your own life, I want you to try doing a few things. Ask yourself, what would it look like to go to Jesus as a source of joy? What would it look like to try to find joy in Jesus in this season right now? I mean, it could be as simple as praying and asking Jesus to give you joy, even when things are difficult, or asking him to help change your perspective. Choosing joy could look like taking time to surround yourself with music or nature or other things that help you clear your mind in order to be more aware of where joy can come in. The other thing I want you to do is this. Just remember that whatever you see in front of you, if it's a challenging situation especially, remember that it's not the whole story. The thing that feels difficult right now may end up bringing you a sense of purpose or understanding later that you didn't think was possible. See, Jesus endured death on a cross, but the cross wasn't the whole story. There was joy in knowing that the cross wouldn't be the end. It was actually the start of better things. It was terrible and miserable, but it gave us a message of what God was really like, and that is what brings us joy. So, as we head to group today, I want you to spend time with your leaders in conversation and others, and I want you to start thinking about an area of your life where you could really use some joy, like real joy. Think through an area where you thought that maybe if things were different, you could have joy. And I want you to begin thinking about what joy could look like even if nothing changed in that situation. Remember, like, none of us have a life where everything is perfect, but all of us can have access to joy, a joy that God made, a joy that God made possible, and it wasn't dependent on anything else except his goodness. So remember, where there is not joy, bring it this holiday season.